Amen. I'm so thankful for all those who have led us in worship tonight through singing, through playing the instruments, those who work with all of the technology. We are your debtors tonight for the privilege of being led by you to worship our Savior Jesus. Brother LeBron, thank you for giving me the distinct and humbling honor to be in this pulpit. I know the position that you take on the Word of God and on the men that you would allow to be in this sacred desk. I do not take lightly the assignment that heaven has set out before us tonight. Thank you for allowing me to come. And thanks to each of you for being here. I realize that it's a Monday evening, and that means there are literally thousands upon thousands of places represented by this congregation tonight where you could have been, but you have been drawn by the Spirit of our God to be in the house of our God, to spend some time in the Word of our God, that we might be changed more and more into the image of our God for the glory of our God. Would you take your Bible tonight and turn with me to the Old Testament and the book of Ruth? I want to call your attention to the book of Ruth, chapter 1. During the service tonight, I changed my sermon 5 or 6 different times. And when Pastor was sharing a prayer request just a moment ago, I even thought about turning to Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, and preaching a sermon called The Snake in the Glass. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is a brawler, and whoever is deceived thereby is not wise. That's on my podcast. You can go find that. But tonight, we're going to be in the book of Ruth. A few weeks ago, in the church where I'm privileged to be a member and pastor, God led me to preach this sermon from the book of Ruth, chapter 1. I was led of God to preach it again last week in a similar Monday night series of meetings not very far from here, and the Lord has led me back to this particular message. Again, I believe that our host pastor nearly prayed the theme of this message, because even though we are looking at a faithful group of people on a Monday night, a marvelous Monday, Super Monday, in fact, and even though this is, to a large degree, an older congregation, he prayed that if the Spirit of God has perhaps drawn someone into this building that is far from God, that they would see the lovely Lord Jesus Christ tonight standing with arms open wide, welcoming you as the Father did to the prodigal son. Come home, come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Tonight from Ruth chapter 1, we're going to read and study the first 7 verses, and I'm preaching on this subject tonight. I've wandered far away from God. Ruth chapter 1, we begin reading in verse 1. If you're able and willing, I'll invite you to stand to your feet to show honor and reverence to the reading of God's inspired, infallible, and inerrant word. Ruth chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. And now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his 2 sons. And the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his 2 sons Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. And Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her 2 sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they dwelled there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. And the woman, Naomi, was left of her 2 sons and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her 2 daughters-in-law with her, and they went on the way to return unto the land of Judah. Father in heaven, would you bless now the reading of your word? And I pray that the scarlet thread of redemption that runs from Genesis chapter 1 through Revelation chapter 22 would cause this text, this service, and this very message to drip with the blood of Calvary, a blood that still cleanses from any and every and all sin, a blood that is still able to make even the foulest clean. And I pray that tonight, if there is one lost in the darkness and death of their sin, that tonight you would draw them by the power of your Holy Spirit, and when the invitation is given, you would save them by your marvelous grace. And perhaps for one that is here tonight that is your child, but has drifted far away from you, and tonight their relationship is desperately distant from your heart, I pray that this very night would be a night of spiritual homecoming, and that in each and every aspect of this service and our response to this message, that Jesus Christ would be glorified. Show us Jesus in this service. May He be pleased and praised. We make our prayer in Christ's name. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. Would you take your seats, please? Bible students know the story of Ruth is a story of redemption. When we come into the second chapter, the woman we met tonight, Ruth, will be introduced to one known as a kinsman redeemer. His name is Boaz. And if you do not know the story of Ruth, I would encourage you, it's only four chapters long, would take you less than 30 minutes to read it in its entirety. Tonight, I would encourage you, and I would ask you, before you lay your head on your pillow, go home and read this wonderful, marvelous story of Ruth. It's not really the story of a man and his love for his wife. It's the story of the lovely Lord Jesus Christ and the love that He has for His chosen bride, the church. Even though this wonderful story of Ruth ends on a high note of redemption, with even a genealogical hint that there would come one born of the virgin who would die on a cross for the sins of the world and be bodily raised from the dead, although the story ends on a high note of redemption, it ends with a tragic note, or begins rather, with a tragic note of backsliding. For this wonderful love story of Ruth begins with a backslidden trip down to the wicked city of Moab. And this journey into Moab, the assimilation into Moabite society, and ultimately the death of three men, a man and his two sons in Moab, is a picture of what happens when a child of God wanders far from God. Now I know who I'm preaching to tonight. Brother Mike, it's Super Monday. It's still warm enough to be over at the beach. But we're in God's house. May I remind you that in the lovely story of the prodigal son, you remember the boy took his father's inheritance and went off into the far country and wasted his father's living with riotous living. May I remind you that it was the elder brother who never left the house that was the spiritual villain of that story. May I remind you that Isaiah said, and Jesus quoted of His own people, that they worship Me with their lips, but their heart is far from Me. May I remind you that in the closing book of your Bible, in Revelation chapter 2, the ascended Lord Jesus Christ dictates a letter through the Apostle John to the backslidden church at Ephesus. And Jesus said to that cold-hearted church, I know your work. I know that you work hard. I know that you labor hard. I know that you faithfully teach Sunday school. I know that you faithfully serve as a deacon. I know that you faithfully work on the committees of the church. I know that you drive the bus. I know that you drive the van. I know that you change diapers in the nursery and work in the Awana. I know that you give. I know that you tithe. I know that you pray. I know that you soul win. But yet I've got something against you. Even though you've got sound doctrine and even though you've got faithful labor, what I've got against you is you have left your first love. I make no apology tonight to preach to a predominantly senior adult crowd on a Monday night that it's possible that somebody in this building, some man, some woman, some boy or girl, whether you are young or whether you are old, it's possible that you may be in the house of God every time the doors are open, but the problem is not your location of your body. The problem is the condition of your heart. For when it comes to wandering far from God, the issue is a matter of intimacy, not of proximity. You can be in the house of God every time the people of God gathered, and yet your heart could be desperately distant from God. I wonder tonight, could God have brought me up to this place because someone has wandered far away from God? Now, there are three simple truths that I want to bring out of these opening seven verses of the book of Ruth. The first thing I want you to notice with me is the difficult time in which they lived. The difficult time in which they live. Someone here tonight might say, Brother Mike, it's just so hard to live for God these days. I agree with you, but also submit to you that's nothing new. It's always been hard to live for the Lord. Why, even in the days where Jesus Himself walked on the face of the earth, He said to His apostles, in this world ye shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. He said to his own first century disciples, if they hated me, they're going to hate you. But don't forget when they hate you that they hated me before they hated you. The Bible says that all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. I'm telling you tonight, if you find it hard to live for God in these days of difficulty and darkness, you can't blame this president or any other president for that. It's not hard to live for God because of any decision of the Supreme Court. It's hard to live for God because it's always been hard to live for God. Elimelech, Naomi, and their two boys, Mahlon and Chilion, lived in difficult times. Charles Dickens, the great writer, wrote about the days of the French Revolution, and you know that story began by him declaring that it was the best of times and it was the worst of times. Elimelech would simply say, the days in which I lived, they were just the worst of times. The Bible tells us about this difficult time in verse 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. That tells us, first of all, this difficult time was marked by three things. Now, first, it was marked by a time of political chaos. Political chaos. This word now that opens up the book of Ruth connects us to the book that precedes it, the days of the judges. Many of God's children think that the Bible was written just in straight chronological order, and we think that the story of Ruth happened after the days of the judges. But chapter 1 and verse 1 tells us that this event occurred in the days when the judges ruled. You could take the book of Judges and lay it out like this, and chronologically, you could take the story of Ruth and Boaz and lay it right into the midst of the time of the days of the judges. Why is that important for us to understand tonight? Because the last verse of the book of Judges describes the time of the days of the judges. Now, in those days, there was no king in the land of Israel, and every man did what was right in his own eyes. Brothers and sisters, have you noticed that when every man does what is right in his own eyes, most people don't do right, they do wrong? We live in a day of political chaos. No longer is the presidency a respected office. No longer is there respect for the Congress. No longer is there respect for the governor. No longer is there respect for the pastor. No longer is there respect for the president. We live in a day where if you wear the blue uniform to protect and to defend the people of your community, you're just as likely to be shot in the line of duty as anything else. There's no more respect for authority in this world. And I'm telling you, when you live in a day where nobody can rule over you and nobody can tell you what to do, and you're going to do what you want to do when you want to do it, and you're not going to have anybody ruling over you, I'm telling you, you're hearkening back to the days of the judges, doing what is right in your own eyes, and it's usually going to be wrong in the eyes of Almighty God. We live in a day where up is down and left is right and off is on and hot is cold, and we call evil good and good evil. We live in a day of political chaos. You say, Brother Mike, I don't really know if it's a day of political chaos. Hey, listen to me. You can't even go to Walmart anymore and buy school supplies without having the fear of being gunned down on aisle 7, minding your own business. I'm telling you, these are dark days in these United States of America, but that's nothing new. It was a dark time of political chaos in the days of Naomi and Elimelech. It was a time of political chaos. It was therefore also, secondly, a time of personal compromise. For the Bible says that now it happened, it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled. For you see, over and over and over again, the book of Judges, again, the time period for the book of Ruth, says that the sons of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the anger of the Lord burned against the sons of Israel. Now, why in the world was God angry? In a disciplinary way, why was God providentially angry with his own people? It's simply because they were not walking in obedience. And by the way, if your God does not discipline his children when they disobey him, then either you are serving the wrong God or you've got an unbiblical view of the one true God. The Bible tells us that when they entered into the land of promise, God said, when you cross over the Jordan, I'm going to use you, but I want you to drive out all the Canaanites and all of the pagan people that are there. If you don't, they're going to be a perpetual thorn in your side. When you go in, I don't want you to intermarry with them. I don't want you to give your sons to their daughters, and I don't want you to give your daughters to their sons. Here's why. Because evangelistic dating never worked, it doesn't work now, and it never has. You get to hanging out with the wrong crowd, you get in partnership with the wrong crowd, and they're going to pull you down a whole lot faster than you'll ever pull them up. But the people of God did not do what God told them to do. When they went into the promised land, they gave their sons to these pagan daughters to marry, and they gave their daughters to these pagan boys to marry, and they settled down and they settled in. They were living a life of political chaos. They were living a life of personal compromise. Compromise is a word that you don't hear in many Baptist pulpits anymore. In fact, I know this pastor preaches it plain and straight, and that means you know that when you preach about compromise, you'll get called backwood, fundamentalist, narrow-minded, legalistic, homophobic, bigoted. You're a backwater hayseed because you talk about compromise. You'll be called legalistic, and they'll ask you what kind of Kool-Aid they drink up at the Living Waters Baptist Church. Compromise. What is compromise? Compromise is when you just begin to dabble with a little bit of sin in your life. Nobody would ever be able to convince you that you're beginning to stray from the Lord. What does compromise look like in our day? You say, preacher, I've not given my son to marry a Moabite woman, and I've not given my daughter to marry a Moabite man. No, but you'll have a little alcohol around the house for those special occasions, having no understanding whatsoever that you're going to lead your children into a lifestyle of drunkenness because of a little bit of compromise. You've got HBO and Showtime on your satellite because you say you've got it for the sports. You like to watch boxing. You say, preacher, I don't ever watch any of those ugly shows on Friday night and Saturday night. First of all, liar, liar, pants on fire. I'm talking about compromise. I'm talking about just beginning to dabble in sin. A little dab may do you if you're talking about Brill Cream, but a little dab will kill you if you're talking about sin. I'm with an older crowd tonight. I thought I could talk about a little Brill Cream. I heard about a queen that was interviewing for a new chariot driver. And she needed a man that would drive her chariot in which she would ride. She had one question for them. She knew that anybody that would audition or apply to be her chariot driver would know about a very dangerous cliff out in the far corner of the kingdom. There was a very precipitous and dangerous road that made its way up through that part of the country. Why, at one of the narrowest passes in that mountain road, the chariot would barely be able to make it across that dangerous road. So she brought each of those drivers in and she asked them all one question. Exactly how close to the edge of that road and the edge of that fatal cliff do you think you could get my chariot without me falling to my death? And the first one said, why, queen, I'm so gifted in the driving of a chariot, I could get your chariot wheel within an eighth of an inch of the edge. The second one said, I could do better than that. I'm so gifted at driving the chariot, I could get your outside wheel within a 32nd of an inch of that fatal edge. And the third man stepped up and he said, oh, if my queen was in my chariot, I'd be so close to the safe side of the mountain, I'd be scrubbing the inside edge, I'd stay as far away from the edge of that cliff as I could possibly get. And he got the job. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you tonight, if you're a child of God, you don't carry a queen in your chariot, but you carry within your heart the spirit of the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. And we ought not be saying, how close can we get to sin without it destroying our life and destroying our family and destroying our testimony and destroying our church? We ought to be saying, how close can I get and how close can I live to the precious Lord Jesus Christ? Elimelech lived in a difficult time, marked by political chaos, marked by personal compromise. This difficult time, thirdly, was marked by providential chastening. For the Bible says in verse 1, "Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land." Now if you want to take notes, you could write down Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 17. And in 2 Chronicles 7, 13, these are but two passages in the Old Testament where God told His people that He would, at least on some occasions, use famine as a form of discipline. Now, I don't know what kind of discipline you use at your house. Some of the young families that I have in my church, they use time out. And you can tell it when you get around their kids. My daddy didn't use time out. I don't know for sure that my daddy could even count to two. You ever in Walmart and these parents talk to their kids, "Don't make me tell you again, I'm going to count to three now. One, two, one, don't make me get to three." I don't know that my daddy could even count to two. He said, "I'm going to tell you one time and that's all it's going to be." My daddy would make me go to the back bedroom and bring him one of his extra belts. I think he got that from his mama, my granny, when she would discipline us. And how many of you had grannies that would still spank you? She would send us out in the yard to cut our own switch. And you better bring back a good stiff switch too. If granny had to go cut a switch, it was going to be real bad. Well, my daddy used a belt. My granny used a switch. But I want to ask the question, what does God use to discipline His children? He uses a lot of things. And in the case of Naomi and Elimelech and the people of Bethlehem, God said, "I've had enough of your rebellion and your disobedience, and I'm going to discipline you with famine." The heavens turned to brass, the fields turned to bronze, and the pantry turned to dust. And rather than difficulty driving them back to the heart of God, they allowed a time of difficulty to drive them further from God. For you see, in the Bible, there are several places geographically that are typological. They are picturesque or symbolic of sin. You never read anything good that happens from going down to this particular place. You never read anything good that happens when God's people would go down to Egypt. And you never read anything good that would happen when God's people would go down to Moab. In a time of providential chastisement, these people began to stray from God. The difficult time in which they lived. There's a second main truth that I want you to notice in this text, and I want you to lean in close to the Scripture as we consider not only the difficult time in which they live, but the disobedient turn that they took. The Bible says in our text that a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab. Moab, as I've just suggested, was a dark and spiritual place. Moab, nothing good ever came out of Moab. Moab was actually named for its great forefather. Do you remember who Moab was? Moab was both the son and the grandson of Lot. Yes, you heard me right. For the children that are in the building tonight, I'm going to say this very graciously. But Lot was one of the sole survivors of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. You remember the angels of God had to grab him by the hand and drag him out, kicking and screaming from the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. He got out only with his wife. She turned around, turned into a pillar of salt, and he had his two carnally minded daughters. They reasoned in their mind, "All the men that we know died in the destruction of Sodom. Why, if we are to have any children in our womb, the only man that we know is Daddy, and the only way that we can have that kind of relationship with Daddy, we've got to get Daddy drunk. Here's what we're going to do. We'll get Daddy drunk." We're going back to the danger of alcohol. Nothing good ever came out of a bottle of liquor. We'll get Daddy drunk. You can lay with him tonight, and we'll get him drunk again tomorrow night, and it'll be my turn. And that's how this man named Lot fathered his own grandchildren on a drunken bed of incest and was so intoxicated with strong drink he didn't even know what he had done. One of those boys was named Ammon, and the other one was named Moab. That's the spiritual heritage of the people of the city of Moab. And then, of course, during the days of the Exodus, when the people of God were traveling out of Egypt into the land of promise, they wanted to take a shortcut and walk across the land of their cousins, the Moabites, and the king of Moab would not let them. And so God pronounced a curse on the land and the people of Moab. So much so that when the temple of God would later be built, none of the Ammonites and none of the Moabites were even allowed to go into the temple. And yet that's the place. Listen to me, church. Yet that's the place that Elimelech decides to take his family. It's instructive to me that they left Bethlehem to go to Moab looking for bread. Do you know what the name Bethlehem means? The house of bread. They left God's house of bread going to Moab looking for bread. You say that doesn't make any sense. Doesn't make a bit more sense, doesn't make a bit less sense than faithful church members saying, "Pastor, we're not going to be here 2 weekends out of the month because Junior's got on this travel ball team, but we want you to know we're going to get at the hotel every weekend. We're going to do a 10-minute devotional because we want our son to understand the importance of the things of God." First of all, do you mean to tell me that you want to relegate and minimize what happens in the house of God every Sunday morning with the choir singing and the saints clapping and the preacher preaching and the saints singing? You're going to relegate that down to a 10-minute devotional in the Continental Breakfast Area at the Hampton Inn? You've got to be out of your cotton picking mind. Let me tell you something. You can't leave the house of bread and go out to Moab and think you're going to find bread that's going to satisfy the hunger of the soul that needs to be feasting on the manna from the table of the Word of God. But they left the house of bread and went out into the world looking for bread. Friend, I'm telling you, the thing that you're looking for, if you're a child of God, oh, the thing that you're looking for can be found at the house of God. I'm telling you tonight, there's still a fountain and it flows from the heart of God and it can satisfy the thirstiest soul, and you'll find it by clinging closely to the heart of God. But that's not what Elimelech did. Note with me this disobedient turn that they took involves three things. I just want to answer three questions for you tonight. First of all, I want us to think about why they left. Why they left? For the Bible simply says in verse 1, "A certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab." You see, the tragedy of this wrong turn is that it was an intentional turn. In this case, he did not drift off to Moab. He didn't take a wrong turn at Albuquerque and end up in Moab. He left Bethlehem and had entered Moab in his GPS. He intended to turn to Moab. He just did not intend for that intentional turn to turn out like that intentional turn turned out. Beloved, this is a reminder from the pages of the Old Testament that you can pick your choices, but you cannot pick your consequences. Don't get the idea that this was a good decision that just turned out bad. This was a dumb spiritual decision from the very start. Let me illustrate what I mean by that. I said this was not a good decision that turned out bad. This was a bad decision from the start that manifested in the end how bad it was at the beginning. Let me illustrate what I mean by that. I want you to imagine two millionaire investors, and they're both going to invest $1 million into a company. One millionaire invests his millions into Apple computers. Sounds like a wise decision, doesn't it? What he doesn't realize is that his broker was a man named Bernie Madoff. That was an otherwise good decision that just turned out bad because of some unforeseen circumstances. But now, on the other hand, there's a millionaire. He's going to invest his millions into a company that's going to sell air conditioners at the North Pole. Dumb as dirt before he finishes writing his name on the check. What I want you to see is this decision to leave Bethlehem, even in the famine, and go down to Moab looking for bread. It was a stupid spiritual decision before they finished packing up the minivan, because there's no smart way to disobey God. There's no such thing as a smart turn onto Disobedience Boulevard. The only right turn you can make on Dumb Avenue is a U-turn to get back right with God. This decision was foolish, watch this, not because of how it turned out, but because of how it started. And you see, the devil will anesthetize you and blind you and blind your children and your grandchildren to the foolishness of a disobedient turn by camouflaging it with success. This hadn't turned out bad. Look how well things are going. Preacher told me I shouldn't do this. Look how great it's turned out. This decision was not a bad decision because of how it turned out, but because of the direction that it turned. This would have been a bad decision if Elimelech had gone down to Moab, made $1 million selling Jewish bagels to pilgrims coming from the city of Bethlehem. It was dumb as dirt because he was disobeying the word of God. Why they left? I'll tell you why they left. Because they were walking by sight and not by faith. One of the things that the devil will do, he will convince you that a wrong move is the right turn. That's why we had better make our decisions based on one unchanging, unchangeable standard, and that's the blessed book we call the Word of God. We consider today why they left. There's a second thing I want to answer, and that is where they lived. Where they lived. Now we know, of course, that they lived in Moab. But Pastor, when I say where they lived, I'm not emphasizing the word where. We know that's Moab. I want to take a moment and emphasize the word lived. Where they lived. I'm confident that I'm preaching tonight in a church that believes in what we call the verbal plenary inspiration of Scripture. Bible students know the word plenary means full, total, and complete. We believe all of the Bible is inspired. We believe the miracles. We believe Jesus walked on water, turned water to wine, healed the sick, cleansed the leper, even raised the dead. We believe the Bible from Genesis chapter 1 to Revelation chapter 22. That's the full, total, complete, plenary inspiration of Scripture. We believe all the Word of God. Amen? But we believe something even more specific than that. We believe in what's called the verbal inspiration of Scripture, that not only is all of the Bible inspired of God on the whole, but every individual word of God is inspired. In fact, we believe it a little more specific than that. According to the words of Jesus, we believe that every jot and every tittle is inspired. We believe in the inspiration of the dotting of the I's and the crossing of the T's. You say, Brother Mike, what are you getting at? There are three very specific and individual words that I want to point out to you in this text as we think about where they lived. Notice with me at the beginning of our text. At the end of verse 1, the Bible says that this family went to sojourn. King James, do you see the word sojourn? They went to sojourn in the country of Moab. Now look at the very end of verse 2. After they got down to Moab, the Bible says that they continued there. Now look at the end of verse 4. And they dwelled there about 10 years. Psalm 108 verse 9 is where God calls Moab his washpot. They left the house of bread. They left the land of Judah, which by the way means praise. They left the place of praise to go to the place that God called his washpot. J. Vernon McGee said that word washpot describes something that would be the washing of the hands, but most Bible commentators say that word washpot describing Moab is better described by the idea of a chamber pot. I can tell by your groaning you understand chamber pot. They left the house of praise to go to the toilet bowl of the world.
Amen,
they lived there for 10 years. You say, who in the world would make a decision to leave the house of bread, a place where God was pouring out blessings, and go down to the toilet bowl of the world? Who would make a decision to do that, to leave Bethlehem and go live in Moab for 10 years? Listen carefully, nobody. Not even Elimelech. Why, when they were loading up their wagon to head off to Moab, if you had tried to tell him that they were going to have a 10-year trip down to Moab, he would have called you a liar to your face. Why, in verse 1, he would have told you, we're not going to continue in Moab, and we're sure not going to dwell in Moab. We're just going to sojourn down in Moab. You say, what are you getting at, preacher? Well, in our English vernacular, we use these different kind of words too. For example, if I were going to leave the city of Blackshear and move up to North Myrtle Beach, I'd put a sign in my yard, we'd sell our house, we'd buy a house here, and I'd tell all my family and friends, we're moving to Myrtle Beach. But now when I run over to Walmart, I don't tell my family, what, y'all, I'm going to miss y'all, I'm moving to Walmart. Some of you ladies live at Walmart. But I say, I'm going to Walmart. That's the same way these words are used. Elimelech would have told you, I'm not moving to Moab. I'm just going to go down to Moab for a weekend trip. It's a grocery run. Moab's the wash pot of God. Moab is the cesspool. It's the septic tank. It's the open sewer of the known world. I would never try to go raise my family down there. You're being too religious. You're being too narrow-minded. Why? We're not even going to have the mail stop. We're going to be back on Monday. We're just going to go sojourn in Moab. I could not begin to count for you the number of people who just began to drift and drift and drift and drift and drift away from God. And you could tell them, you're making foolish decisions. And they say, oh no, I'm never going to end up over there. Like Lot pitching his tent towards Sodom, you would have never convinced him that he would have lost his family and lost his testimony and nearly lost his life down in the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And here's Elimelech doing the exact same thing. His family stayed down there for 10 years. And he and his two boys don't even live to get out of there alive. Where they lived is a testimony of this timeless truth. Sin will take you farther than you want to go. Sin will show you more than you want to know. Sin will keep you longer than you want to stay. And sin will cost you more than you want to pay. Look right here and listen to me very carefully. From the heart of a pastor. If you're living in Moab tonight, get out.
Amen.
And get back to Bethlehem. If you've turned and you're on the road going down to Moab, make a U-turn.
Amen.
It's not going to go well down there. Why they left? Where they lived. Note thirdly what they lost. We read the text just a moment ago. Elimelech lost his life. Mahlon lost his life. Chilion lost his life. Now I want to be very, very clear and I want to be very, very careful. We would be presumptuous and somewhat spiritually arrogant to assume that these three deaths were the judgment of God for their sin. We don't know that for sure. But we would be equally foolish to not at least consider that as a possibility.
Yes, sir. Yes.
That God had gotten a belly full. You say, my God wouldn't do that. The God of the New Testament in 1 John 5 still says there is a sin unto death that a child of God can commit. May I remind you that at the Living Waters Baptist Church of Corinth, some of them were abusing the Lord's Supper table, and it was populating the church cemetery out back.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
New Testament.
Yes, sir.
Am I preaching that right, Pastor? New Testament. We'd be foolish to not consider that this difficulty and this loss was the just chastisement of a holy God who said, whom I love, I'm going to chasten, and I will scourge every son whom I receive.
Yeah.
I've never buried a spouse. Although we've miscarried, I've never buried a child. In a group this size, some of you know what it's like to walk to the cemetery, go to the funeral home and pick out a casket, kiss that husband or wife one last time, close the lid, and walk away. I don't mean to bring up painful emotions from your own memory, but I do say this. Don't just read so quickly over this story and forget this was a real woman who buried her real husband. And then after that, she experienced what would have to be the most difficult and painful thing that God could ever allow to happen in a life in this world. She buried one of her children. In a group this size, some of you have had that terrible task. But she didn't just bury one. She buried two. And she didn't just bury two. She buried both. By that I mean she buried two out of two. And she's alone. Again, I don't say that to help to try to bring up painful memories that may be in your life. But I want you to picture Naomi and her two newly widowed daughters-in-law standing over three tear-stained graves in Moab. And the epitaph on Elimelech's headstone might say, there's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. It never turns out well when you take a disobedient turn away from God. The difficult time they lived, the disobedient turn they took. But there's a third gracious and glorious truth I want you to see. Not only the difficult time they lived and the disobedient turn they took, but the divine truth they experienced. For you see, these opening verses of Ruth tell us a number of things about a number of people. In these verses, we learn some things about Elimelech. We learn some things about Naomi. Hey, we learn some things about Mahlon and Chilion. We even learn a few things about Orpah and Ruth. But most importantly, we learn some things here about God. There's divine truth that is revealed in this text. And for anyone in this building, anyone watching online, listening to a recording of this message later, there are three fundamental truths that I believe God sent me to North Myrtle Beach tonight to share with you. Three truths about our Creator God. First of all, this text says something about the will of God for you. The will of God for you. Look at verse 6. And then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how the Lord capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, how Yahweh, how Jehovah, how the God of promise, how the God that's a covenant keeper, how the God who's never gone back on his word, how a God that's never forsaken his people, how a God who's never violated his own oath, how that loving, covenant-keeping, promise-making God had visited his people in giving them bread. Verse 6, wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was. Verse 7 says, and they went on the way to return unto the land of Judah. Again, believing in the verbal inspiration of Scripture, we think that God intended to put these prepositions here. Watch this very carefully, because this is an Old Testament picture of New Testament repentance. You say, preacher, what's the will of God for somebody that's drifted far from God? Naomi said, I've heard a word from the Lord. And I'm going to get up from where I am, and I'm going to go back to where I used to be. I'm going to get up from, and I'm going to go unto. Don't miss both parts of that. I'm going to get up from, and I'm going unto. I'm getting up from where I am, and I'm going unto where I ought to be. Why is that important? Because I know a lot of people that want to get up from the mess of their life, but they don't want to go unto the place that God has called them to be. They want to go from this mess into self-help, from this mess into religion, from this mess into pulling myself up by my own bootstraps, from this mess into trying harder, from this mess into doing better. I've come tonight to tell you, if there's any hope for you, you've got to hear the will of God, and that is for you to get up from where you are and go unto the place where God is calling you. This is an Old Testament example of what Jesus taught in the New Testament Gospel of Luke. Do you remember in chapter 15 the story of the prodigal son? Man, he went off and he wasted his father's money with riotous living, finds himself in the pig pen eating the husk that the swine did eat, but no man gave him anything. Do you remember what the Bible says he did? The Bible says he came to himself and he said, self, how many of my father's servants have bread and enough to spare? And I'm here perishing with hunger. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to get up from where I am. And I'm going to go back to my father's house. And I'm going to tell him, Father, I've sinned against heaven, and I've sinned in your sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired servants. And with full repentant intention, he got up from where he was and went back to where he ought to be. And that is the will of God for you and for anyone and everyone that's wandered far away from God. Tonight you may say, preacher, you really think that's the will of God for me? After what I've done, after how long I've been away, after the way my mind has been messed up, and the words that I've said and the thoughts that I've had and the things that I've done, the way I have turned my back on God, is it the will of God for me to come home? I don't mean to mess with your theology unless you're wrong. But if you're here tonight even wondering whether or not God wants you to come home, you wouldn't even have the spiritual sense to be asking that question if your heavenly Father wasn't standing down at the end of the road looking for you, calling for you, convicting you, wooing you back into his presence tonight. If you'll lean your ear into this text, you too will hear the word of the Lord. There's bread back in Bethlehem. That text will not only speak to you, it'll sing to you. And it'll sound like this: come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home earnestly, tenderly. Jesus is calling, oh sinner, come home. That's the will of God for you. There's a second divine truth that we see in this text. Not only the will of God for you, but the word of God to you. For the Bible says in verse 6, for she had heard in the country of Moab, not how it had started raining, not how the grass had started growing, Not even how the barley harvest was coming in. What had she heard down in Moab? That the Lord had visited his people. I want to ask you a question tonight. When I read this, I'm just a simple country preacher preaching a simple sermon to what I think are some simple people at the Living Waters Baptist Church. So I had to ask myself this question. It was about 50 miles from Bethlehem down to Moab. This was before modern technology. This was before you could post on Facebook, "Hey, bread in Bethlehem, y'all come back." This was before Twitter, Instagram. This was before television, telephone, telegram, telebutician. This was long before the normal ways that we would try to spread the word. How exactly is it that Naomi heard that God had visited his people? I don't know for sure. But since this is my sermon, I'm going to give you my inspired speculation. I think God said, "My discipline against my people is over. I'm going to send the rain. The ground's going to get fertile again. Just in time to grow some barley. Just in time to harvest some grain. Just in time to make some bread. Gabriel, whether we have to send an angel or some other messenger, make sure somebody goes down to Moab and tells Naomi, I want her to come home." I don't know that for sure, but I do know what it looks like in your case. God sent a skinny little preacher up from Southeast Georgia to preach on a Super Monday at the Living Waters Baptist Church to get word to you that he's a loving father. He's better at forgiving your sin than you are at committing those sins. He's better at welcoming you home than you are at straying from home. And he sent me here tonight to tell you it's time for you to come home. That's the word of God. Amen. To you. Now, there's something interesting that happens in the balance of this chapter. Bible students know the story. Now, I know there's a little problem with the microphone, but just stay with me. Tune in. Tune in and listen right here. You going to give me this one? All right. Can you hear me on this one? Guest one. Is that better? All right, I want you to watch what happens here. Naomi hears there's bread back in Bethlehem, so she does not say, "I need to get my life together before I go back." She does not say, "I need to get all this stuff cleaned up before she goes back." She gets up and she goes back to Bethlehem. Now, on the way there, presumably right as they start to leave Moab, she turns to her two daughters-in-law, and for some mysterious and inexplicable reason, she tries to get her two Moabite daughters-in-law to stay in Moab and not go with her back to Bethlehem. One, of course, takes her counsel and stays there. The other, Ruth, goes on to Bethlehem, and she becomes the great heroine of the story. We ought to ask ourselves a question. Why would this woman, going back to where God wanted her to be, turn to somebody with her and say, in essence, "I don't want you to go with me"? Don't know for sure. But do you know what a lot of commentators suggest? Many commentators speculate that she did not want those two Moabite daughters-in-law to go back to Bethlehem with her because they were a symbol of her backslidden life, and she would have to explain that part of her testimony to the good religious Jewish women of Bethlehem. I mean, it's going to be hard enough to explain what happened to her husband and her boys, but where did these two Moabite women come from? I don't know if that's true or not, but Pastor, I have seen similar things happen in the lives of God's people in my own ministry. You can't get right with God. You can't get back in the church.
They all know you're not married. How are you going to explain that baby? They know that baby got here the old-fashioned way. You can't go back in that condition. People will talk about you. They'll look down on you. You'll have too much to explain why you can't go back to the house of God now. Why, you were married to a different woman when you were here before, and now y'all have divorced and you've gotten married to somebody else. Your families are a rotten, stinking mess. You'll have too much. You can't go back and get right with God in that messy condition you're in. Why? Look at those needle marks in your arm. Why, they saw your name in the paper when you got arrested. If you go back to the church like that, they're going to talk about you. Same thing he might have said to the prodigal laying in the pig pen. You can't go back to the Father's house smelling like a bunch of hogs with all your money gone and your friends gone and your life in shambles. But let me tell you something. In this place tonight, there is a loving Father who will see you in your current condition. He will run to you. He'll put shoes on your feet and a ring on your feet. Finger and a robe on your back. He'll strike up the band and kill Bessie the fatted calf and say, "My son, my daughter, my boy, my girl, they've come home," and they will celebrate. And the people in this church will celebrate with the angels of heaven that a sinner has come home to the house of God. Naomi would say to you, it's time for you to come home, and if you're going to come home, you've got to come home just like you are. That's the word of God to you. There's the will of God for you. We're talking about divine truth that they experience. There's a third and final thing, and that's the work of God through you. Notice what the text says. I'm not making this up. I'm just giving you what the Bible says. Look in verse 7. "Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her. And they," all three of them, "went on their way to return unto the land of Judah." Now, we know from the balance of chapter 1 that one of those two daughters-in-law decided to stay. But the other one, Ruth, who's the namesake of the book, she went on back to Bethlehem. I'm talking about the work of God through you. Now, Naomi can't see right now, but God's at work. She's broken, she's backslidden, she's bitter. Says that of herself at the end of the chapter. But she doesn't have any clue that even though her life has been messed up as she and her family have strayed far away from God, God is not finished with her. In fact, her greatest contribution to the kingdom of God is just around the corner. Now, we don't have time tonight, but I'm going to give you the Mike Stone Cliff's Notes version. Would that be okay? Then we're going to give the invitation and go home. You see, when Naomi and Ruth got back to the city of Bethlehem, they came at the beginning of the barley harvest. It was customary in that time that the wealthy landowners would not reap the corners of their field. They would leave those corners and all of the gleanings for the widows and for the orphans, for the poor. So when they get there at the beginning of the barley harvest, that's the end of chapter 1, Ruth says to her mother-in-law, "I'm going to go out and I'm going to get us some supper for tonight." But when she goes, she just happens to end up in the field of a man named Boaz. And again, I'm going to describe this the way we would describe it down in South Georgia. Boaz looks at some of his workers. He sees this good-looking woman gleaning in the corners of the field, and he says, "Woochie mama, who is that?" That's the Hebrew. Somebody says, that's the daughter-in-law of Naomi that came up out of Moab. And he said, "Drop some barley in front of her on purpose. Leave some extra. I want her to go home with a bunch of food today. And hey, if you see any of these guy workers around here that start hitting on her, you knock them in the head. They're going to answer to me." I just added that part. But I believe he said it. So here comes Ruth coming home. She went out to get enough to make a loaf of bread. And she comes home. Can you see her with her skirt pulled out and piled full of barley? Naomi said, "Girl, where'd you get all that bread?" She said, "I met the nicest man. His name was Boaz." "Boaz? Ooh, girl. You don't understand Levirate marriage. You don't understand kinsman redeemer. I'll explain it to you over breakfast. Meanwhile, you go get you a bath. You iron your prettiest dress. You pinch your cheeks and get your makeup laid out. Put on some secret deodorant. Squirt some Chanel number 5 on you. Because tomorrow, you going back to that same field. You're not going looking for bread, honey. You going out tomorrow to get you a man." I know that's a paraphrase, but Pastor, isn't that how the story goes? And sure enough, Ruth had already caught the attention of Boaz, and they began to fall in love with each other, and in the providence of God, they get married. And according to the laws of that day, if they had a child, and they did, and if it was a son, and it was, that son would be the legal son, watch this, of Naomi's dead boy. The son that would be born to Ruth and Boaz would be Naomi's grandson. Well, it just so happened that boy turned out to be the grandson or the grandfather of King David, the greatest king that has yet to sit on the throne of the house of Jacob. But generations later, now Naomi can't see it. Her heart is broken and her life is in shambles. And she thinks God can't use her anymore. She's about to become the great-great-grandmother, not just of King David, but of the son of David. I'm talking about she's in the line of the Lord Jesus Christ, who one day would sit on the throne of his father Jacob and reign over the house of Jacob forever and forever, and of his kingdom there would be no end. She doesn't know it, but God is not only about to bring her home, but he's going to use her for his great glory, and he can do the very same thing for you. I'm telling you tonight, if you've wandered far away from God, God's calling you tonight to come home. God's calling you tonight to come home exactly like you are, and he will invite you home with very good news. I'm not done with you. I'm going to use you, and I'll use your life to point people to Jesus. William Kirkpatrick was a Methodist music minister. He was leading the music for a big citywide tent revival. He was leading the congregational music, but they had brought in a well-known Christian soloist, a gospel singer was doing special music that week. William Kirkpatrick noticed that the singer would sing his solo and slip out and not stay for the preaching. Kind of bothered him. That bothered me too. He began to discern that the singer, though very talented and though very gifted in singing the gospel, perhaps had not fully experienced the gospel himself. So that week, William Kirkpatrick, who was also a prolific hymn writer, decided that he was going to spiritually fix the young soloist. So he wrote a brand new hymn and scheduled the soloist to sing it right before the sermon. That what that means is that in the flow of the service, there'd be no chance for the boy to slip out. He'd sing and the preacher would preach. There'd be no prayer, no handshaking time, absolutely nothing. So here he is. He stands up, he sings this brand new song, and gets stuck in a chair on the platform, and the preacher preached the gospel. And that night, the popular singer made a radical commitment of his life to Jesus. And he would testify that God had used that brand new song to soften his heart. He was the first one to ever sing, "I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. paths of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home. Somebody here tonight needs to say, I'm tired of sin and straying, Lord. But now I'm coming home. I'll trust thy love. I'll believe thy word. Lord, I'm coming home. I've wasted many precious years, but you don't have to waste any more. Now I'm coming home. I now repent in bitter tears. Lord, I'm coming home. Somebody tonight needs to say, I'm coming home. Coming home. Never more to roam. Open wide, he will too, thine arms of love. Lord, I'm coming home. Father in heaven, would you move in this time of invitation? Thank you that you are a better Savior than we are a sinner. And you are slow to anger, quick to forgive. You are abounding in mercy and loving kindness. Would you manifest that to this congregation tonight? Draw that wanderer home to yourself. And we make our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. In about 60 seconds, we're going to stand and we're going to sing. And the staff of this church will be here to receive you. If you are a guest tonight, we're not asking you necessarily to join this church unless you just want to. But tonight, if you need to respond to this invitation, I'm going to ask you to come. If you're here and you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, you come tell one of these men, I want to be saved. They'll know exactly what to do to tell you how you can know the forgiveness of your sin and have a perfect relationship with your Creator. But I believe